What's good, y'all? It's Boy Ross back at again with another video. So I'm going to check out Triple H is back in the WWE Performance Center. Brock Lesnar breaks character. Rhea Ripley brain injury and other wrestling news. There's been a lot of crazy things been going on this week for wrestling. So we're going to check this out. Appreciate all the love and support on the channel. Road to 90K. Let's get right into this one, man.
It is WrestleMania here, back with another video. It's time for AEW's Go Home Dynamite show before Forbidden Door. What surprises should fans expect? Join us now as we look at this week's edition of Dynamite, as well as the wildest news stories and rumors you need to know, including Triple H returns to the Performance Center.
I've been hearing a lot about that.
News on Big E. Jim Ross is cancer-free. Rhea Ripley reveals her injury. Brock Lesnar breaks character after SmackDown, and much more. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell for daily wrestling videos, and follow us on Facebook for exclusive lists. Also check out WrestleMania.co.uk and our non-wrestling channel, Incredible. Now, as always, we won't recap the matches, but just look at the good, the bad, and the downright ugly. As always, we start off with the good as number one, Christian's con. Everything came together as Christian Cage revealed he's been playing Jungle Boy ever since the Jurassic Express.
I have been seeing this. I did see his promo. It was fantastic. His promo where he talked about how he was playing Jungle Boy, how he was getting an easy payday. He even took a shot at MJF saying, if you want to get paid the big bucks, you got to have matches where, you know, saying people will talk about forever. When they start naming pay-per-views after what you've done, then you can worry about the big bucks. And if you guys know, WWE has named a pay-per-view TLC. It is a pay-per-view thing. Edge and Christian, they elevated. They revolutionized tag team wrestling with that TLC concept with them, the Hardys, the Dudleys. They took tag team wrestling TLC. They took that to a whole new level. So I like that he did that. And then he even went mega rogue with what he said about Jungle Boy's father or whatnot and him being dead. I was just like, oh wow. So yeah, that was very, very great. Him going mega ultra rogue was fantastic.
Star eliminated from the Casino Battle Royal last year. Christian played the heel to perfection as he blamed his actions on the fans for cheering his elimination and of course Jungle Boy for eliminating him. Christian went all in on his heel promo, telling Jungle Boy he knew that the young star looked up to him as a father, but that Jungle Boy already has a father and he's dead.
Oh my
Cage
God.
Cage even made sure to mention that Jungle Boy's mom had her eye on him, covering all the bases for a classic heel promo.
Great heel promo.
That wasn't the end of things, as Luchasaurus showed up to confront Cage, only for Christian to seemingly fast talk his way out of a beatdown, telling Luchasaurus he's like a son to him. Number two, Mox is money on the microphone. Another money microphone moment from Moxley.
I haven't seen this segment.
To remind the fans of all he can do, both win Sunday's match against Hiroshi Tanahashi and next week's Blood and Guts bout. John Moxley's promos may seem simplistic as he basically talks about fighting, but like Stone Cold Steve Austin, his authenticity takes it to the next level. Number three, a string of good segments. Now we've discussed Dynamite's effective use of promos, interviews, and backstage segments to forward storylines, and last night was business as usual, whether it was Jade Cargill referencing Red Velvet's injury and the search for a new baddie, Tony Storm's quest for the AEW Women's Championship, or any of the build for the pay-per-view and next week's Blood and Guts special. Number 4, The Bullet Club is back. AEW certainly sweetened the pot for Forbidden Door as the Young Bucks announced a Bullet Club reunion as they team with the Bullet Club members against Darby Allin, Sting, Shingo, Takagi, and Hiromu Takahashi this Sunday. Could this lead to more appearances by the Bullet Club in AEW? Number 5, a brawl to end it all. A wild brawl to end the show, this is one trope that we never get tired with and it's particularly perfect for building pay-per-views. Even better, reports are coming in that the brawl continued after the show went off the air, giving the fans an extra treat. Number 6, no brawl, no problem. AEW also went the opposite direction as Moxley and Tanahashi, who will wrestle for the interim AEW World Championship at Forbidden Door, stared each other down after they won their match. The contrast was unbelievable as Moxley and Tanahashi stood tall in the ring while outside all hell was breaking loose. And hella hype for pay-per-view. AEW stepped up with hyping Forbidden Door, showcasing the Japanese wrestlers set to compete, while also reminding the AEW Galaxy, trademark copyrighted by Chris Jericho, why they should order the pay-per-view. New Japan Pro Wrestling's workers, with one exception, finally got a chance to shine, something AEW should have been doing for the last few weeks. It'll be interesting to see how well the pay-per-view does, not only because it's being held just a month after Double or Nothing, but because it features a number of non-AEW stars. That was a good What About the Bad. It's number one. Why is Will Ospreay losing? Now, although AEW did a better job promoting Forbidden Door this week, its bonkers booking of Will Ospreay has got to have casual fans wondering what the big deal is. He shouldn't be losing matches before Forbidden Door, even tag team matches. Last night's loss was unnecessary. AEW's booking is usually solid, but not in this instance. Number two, Jericho looking sloppy. Chris Jericho looked slow and sloppy last night. As much as we appreciate Jericho's contributions to the industry, something was off last night. Was it illness, injury, the ravages of time? If this was anything more than a bad night, the Wizard needs to consider slowing things down.
The fact that he calls himself the Wizard is
so he can maximize the matches he works in. Otherwise, it may be time for Jericho to step away from the ring. Now, there was nothing downright ugly about the go-home Dynamite, as AEW hyped the matches going into Sunday's pay-per-view, while also building things up for next week's Blood and Guts special. They found a way to generate interest in the pay-per-view and next week's Dynamite without taking away the build for either show. What do you guys think of Dynamite this week? Let us know.
Now, I'm not sure if we're going to be live streaming Forbidden Door. Most likely, you probably won't. But I will check it out, most likely off camera, for you guys. And, you know, I'll talk about it afterwards. But, yeah, I'm not really familiar with a lot of the New Japan Pro wrestlers. But I will be willing to give it a chance and give it a shot, you know, if there's some good wrestling, good storytelling going on.
In the comments down below. Now let's move on to the news. Now first we look at Big E's good news. The top of the news today is an encouraging report from Big E concerning the devastating neck injury he suffered earlier this year. After a fan tweeted her concern about Big E's physical condition, the former champion uploaded a video showing he's regained mobility with his neck. This is great news for Big E and his legions of fans. Next up, Triple H.
That is awesome. I'm glad he's, you know, getting back to, you know, full strength. He got mobility in his neck. That's really all that mattered. We will see if he's able to actually get back into the ring, because I know being able to, you know, move your neck doesn't necessarily mean you'll be able to wrestle again, because it's a very serious surgery and a very serious situation. When anything dealing with your neck, you kind of got to take time and let things naturally heal. So still wishing Big E a speedy recovery, but that's good that he's on the right path.
Returns to the Performance Center. Triple H's return to the Performance Center, at least according to Post Wrestling's John Pollock, who tweeted, according to multiple sources, Paul Levesque was in Orlando today and spoke at the Performance Center. Of the people I heard from, Levesque stated he's back. It is unknown what that entails, but that was the wording I was given. A wrestling cerebral assassin was forced to take time off from his role in NXT last September when he suffered a life-threatening cardiac incident. Wrestling News' Paul Davis added, it's unclear what that means, but if he's back running NXT, then that would be a huge morale booster, as the talent loved working with him. It's interesting that Triple H's return to the Performance Center following his wife Stephanie McMahon's appointment as interim WWE CEO and chairwoman. Considering the potential gravity of the WWE's hush money scandal, people are going to scrutinize every move in the WWE, regardless of whether it's intentional or a coincidence.
Next, that could be very good if he's back in charge running the show for NXT. That's not bad at all. And actually, I did post a poll on my YouTube channel. Hold on, I gotta find it real quick. So I have posted a poll. 8.5K, 8,500 of you guys voted. Should I start back watching NXT? 31% of you said yes. 69% of you said no. A lot of you guys are like, I think I should possibly pass on it. But, you know, the reports, if these are true, Triple H potentially coming back and being the guy to, you know, help these young talents out, that can be another way to, you know, definitely get me to check it out more, only because I know for a fact when Triple H was there, even though it wasn't always the best, I think they started slipping in quality when they was trying to go have the Wednesday Night Wars. They shouldn't have did that. They should have never tried to go back and forth with AEW. I think they should have just stayed their own thing and did it that way. That's when quality started to dip, but there was still a lot of great things that was happening on NXT. So honestly, I may check it out. I may start checking it out, even if the if it's not true that Triple H isn't, you know, really fully in control. I still may give it, just give it a give it a watch through or whatnot. So I may check out the next takeover just for you guys, just to kind of, you know, see if this is something that I would be truly interested in getting back into. So comment down below. Let me know if you guys think I should check out some more NXT or get back into the swing of things.
Next up, a former WWE superstar replacing Bryan Danielson at Forbidden
Door. Yeah, I heard he was injured.
As AEW continues to deal with the rash of injuries, keeping some of its top stars from competing at Sunday's Forbidden Door, the speculation on who will take Bryan Danielson's place against Zack Sabre Jr. While there are a number of wrestlers in and out of AEW, Meltzer discussed who he thinks will show up on Sunday. I think the betting line guy is Claudio Castagnoli. I don't know that as a fact. I mean, the way Bryan Danielson talks sounded to me like the way he talks about Claudio. So Claudio's in AEW. I guess if it is him. There are possibilities it's someone else, but I can't think of anyone else that would be in the spot that's available right now where people wouldn't crap on it. And you know Tony Khan doesn't want people to crap on his mystery guys. It's just one of those unfortunate things. You know, he's out.
Hmm.
Who do you guys think AEW will have Sabre wrestle?
Next up,
Jim Ross
too.
Cancer-free. Mm. There were complications for Jim Ross as JR updated the fans on his Grilling JR podcast about how he's doing since receiving treatment for skin cancer. I got a lesion on my ankle the size of an orange. It's ugly and grotesque. I got a text today from my oncologist. The good news is I don't have skin cancer any longer.
Wow.
The wound is not healed and it's terribly painful. I'm going back to see my doctor. He's got me on some strong antibiotics. I'm taking 3 of them a day, which is strong for me. The Hall of Famer announcer explained what's next for his treatment. He's going to turn me over to a wound specialist, which I've never even heard of. So
yeah.
I'm going to a wound specialist to see if I can get some relief from this bad thing and expedite the healing process. But Ross also described the delicacy of his situation. Walking, standing on my feet for extended lengths of times is very challenging. Something that simplistic. I have to be careful and be smart not to bump into this wound. I have to keep things covered up and padded up so I don't advertently bump into something on that wound, which is the kiss of death. My sheets wake me up. My sheets lying on this wound when I don't have it covered is not good.
Wow.
I'm glad to hear Jim Ross is cancer free, but we send our well wishes to him as he battles what sounds to be a painful predicament.
Yeah, man. Well, I'm glad he is cancer free. That is a blessing. Hopefully he can get that wound checked out, because that don't even sound enjoyable or comfortable at all. Could barely touch it, graze it. So, but I'm just glad that he is cancer free. There's a lot of good news from this video, man. A lot of good things have been happening wrestling wise to counteract the negative things that's been going on these past few weeks. So that is awesome.
Next up, Rhea Ripley reveals
and then
her
we
injury.
Go to an unfortunate situation.
Was omitted from yesterday's news. I'm really sorry about that, but it was just an editing problem. And what is going on with Rhea Ripley? Well, the Nightmare answered the question after a knucklehead posted on her Instagram that she didn't look hurt. But Ripley replied, "Can't see a brain injury. Stop being incompetent and reaching at nothing." As for when Ripley will be back, Meltzer commented on the situation, noting that the WWE doesn't like to mention COVID or concussions, and that he believes that it's the latter.
Mm.
The good news is that Meltzer doesn't believe Ripley will be gone for long.
Okay.
But finally, Brock Lesnar.
And I hope she's able to come back as well, because I believe she was slated to face Bianca Belair and Money in the Bank, but now she can't. So it's the injury bug. It's just, it's all over both companies. It's been hitting people in important storylines like crazy, like these like people that are in important storylines. So I'm just wishing her a speedy recovery as well. It sucks that this is happening, you know?
Lesnar breaks character after SmackDown. And last but not least, fans may be bored with the thought of another Brock versus Roman rematch, but they still love babyface Brock. This was evident from last week's SmackDown, where Lesnar interacted with the fans after the camera stopped rolling. Cowboy Brock fist bumped the fans at ringside and generally had a good time. Lesnar has obviously been having fun ever since his 2021 return, and it shows in his appearances. But there you have it, folks.
I'm not going
to dynamite this.
I've said this before. Brock Lesnar's, like, his what's the word? His return, the cowboy gimmick. It's actually been the best version of Brock I have seen. It's been funny. It's been quite entertaining. And it's cool to see that he's actually having fun. It looks like he's stepping out of his shell. That Pat McAfee interview could tell this is a different Brock. He doesn't really like people, but when he's there, he shows love. I can appreciate that side of him. I just don't care to see the same match with Roman no more. That's my only gripe. It's my only gripe. Him as his character now, I enjoy. It's the best version of Brock because he's having fun. And you can tell he's having fun. You can tell he actually doesn't have a problem being there. It's just the feud. I'm kind of over it. Only thing that could save this match is if somebody potentially cashes in. Do I think it'll be a fun match? Probably so, but we've seen it so many times. There's only so much they could do, but who knows? Maybe they will pull a swerve and surprise us all. We will see. But yeah, man, comment down below. Let me know. Are you guys excited for Forbidden Door this Sunday? Let me know if you guys are looking forward to the whole show. What's your favorite match? Well, what's the most anticipated match you're looking forward to? Who do you think is going to win? I'm not really well-versed in the New Japan Pro Wrestlers, so you may have to lace me up on that. But I appreciate all the love and support on the channel. Road to 90K. Appreciate y'all kicking with me. See y'all next one. Peace.